Hello everyone, and thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos. Today we'll be learning about significant figures and basic concepts of erosion measurement. So let's start with some basics of erosion measurement. Whenever I calculate or try to find out any reading in any physical experiment, there will be some error without doubt. Some errors can be resolved and you can reduce them, but some errors you cannot. And they're called random errors, and they will always persist no matter how you do the experiment. So we repeat the experiment a number of times and we get slightly different readings, and we analyze those different readings to see how accurate we were. So let's say we did an experiment and we found out 5 readings. X1, X2, X4 and X5. These are readings of the same particular quantity we're trying to calculate by doing the experiment 5 separate times. So we define the average value of X as X1 plus X2 plus X3 plus X4 plus X5 by 5. Or a better way to write it would be summation I is equal to 1 to n Xn by n, where n is the total number of readings, which is 5 in this case. And then we need to find out the total error. What we could do is, we could calculate the individual errors and we could add them up and calculate their average. So for example, we could take x1 minus x average, x2 minus x average, and so on. We could take 5 of them and then we could take the average of them. That wouldn't really work because by definition, x average is going to lie between the minimum and maximum values. So some x's, for example, x1 and x3, might be greater than x average, whereas others, for example, x2, x4 and x5, might be smaller than x average. So the total term will try to converge towards 0, and that is not what we want. We could solve that problem by taking the average of the absolute values of the errors instead of taking the average of the errors. But absolute values are not very easy to work with, and we solve this problem in a different manner. We take the average of the squares of the errors, right? So what we do is, because squares will always be positive, so we take x1 minus x average whole square plus dot 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 plus x5 minus x average whole square. So even if x1 is greater than x average or less than x average, x1 minus x average whole square has to be positive. Right, so this solves that problem. We add them up, we divide them by 5, and we take the square root. The reason we take the square root is because error is after all measured in the same units as the actual quantity. If we are measuring time, we want the error to be in seconds as well, not in seconds square. So we take this and we call this sigma. Sigma is the standard deviation, just another word for approximate error. It can be written more neatly as root of 1 by n summation I is equal to 1 to n xi minus x average whole square. Right? So if we calculate the number of readings and sigma turns out to be very small, we can be sure that we've conducted our experiment accurately. And if sigma is very large, then we can be sure that we need to conduct the experiment again. And the reading is often written as x average plus minus sigma. Sometimes if you want to be more careful, you might write the reading as x average plus minus 3 sigma. Though it's not in your course, it can be proved that if you take a number of readings, then x average minus 3 sigma is the range in which there's a greater than 99% chance that the actual value will lie. Right, but for our purposes, it won't matter whether we take x average plus minus sigma or plus minus sigma. All we need to do is, given a number of readings, we should first be able to calculate the average of the readings, and then we need to just take the errors, square them, take the average, take the square root, and that will be the standard deviation. Right, now once we find out the average value and the standard deviation, there's a lot of other things which we can do. We can calculate the errors in composite quantities. Okay, so for example, let's say we measure something and it turns out to be a plus minus delta a. If we do an experiment and this is the value which we find out, right? So delta A in this case is called the absolute error. Let's say we measure the time period of a pendulum and we find it to be 3 plus minus 0.1 seconds. That means the value of time is between 2.9 3.1. So delta A is the absolute error, which will be 0.1 in this case. Delta A by A is called the relative error. So in this case, the absolute error is 0.1, the relative error is 0.1 by 3. And there's another which is simple enough, delta A by A multiplied by 100, which is called the percentage error. Percent error, which in this case will be 0.1 by 3 multiplied by 100. Right. So these are the three important quantities which you need to know. Whenever you see any physical quantity written as 3 plus minus 0.1 seconds, 0.1 will be the absolute error, 0.1 divided by 3 will be the relative error, and really it's the relative error which tells us how accurate our measurement is. For example, if we measure the time to be 3 plus minus 0.1 second, or we measure the time to be 3000 plus minus 0.1 second, the absolute error in both cases is the same. But we know that in the second case, we did a much more accurate measurement, and that is reflected in the relative error, which is going to be much smaller in the second case than in the first case. The absolute error will be the same in both the cases. Right. So, okay, once we found out how to calculate the errors, how to calculate the percentage, relative and absolute errors, we can find out how to calculate the errors in composite quantities. So, let's say I have a quantity C which is equal to A plus B, and we have A is equal to A average plus minus delta A, and we have B is equal to B average plus minus delta B. What we want is C should be equal to C average plus minus delta C, and we want to find out the value of C average and delta C. So let's take an example first. Let's say A is 3 plus minus 0.1 and B is 4 plus minus 0.2. Right. So the average value of C has to be the average value of A plus B, because the errors will cancel out. So C average will be 7 plus minus. What will delta C be? Now to calculate delta C, let's see. The maximum possible value of A plus B is the maximum possible value of A plus the maximum possible value of B. So C max is 7.3. Right, 3.1 and 4.2. Similarly, C min is, if we take this to be 2.9 and this to be 3.8. If we take this to be 2.9 and this to be 3.8, then C min will be 6.7. Right, so we can see that C is 7 plus minus 0.3. We could get the average from here as well, and the error is 0.3. So the rule is, if C is equal to A plus B, then delta C is equal to delta A plus delta B. Right? So this is easy enough. So the absolute errors add up whenever we add two components, two quantities having errors. What about the difference? Let's say D is equal to A minus B. Then I can say that D is equal to D average plus minus delta D. D average, we can see from A minus B, it will be minus 1. So D average will be minus 1 plus minus, what will delta D be? Right. So what is the maximum value of D? You might think that the maximum value of D occurs when we take the maximum value of A and the maximum value of B, but that wouldn't be correct. The maximum value of D needs the maximum value of A and the minimum value of B. So that will be 3.1 minus 3.8. So that will be minus 0.7. For the minimum value of A minus B, we need the minimum value of A and the maximum value of B. So this will be 2.9 minus 4.2. So that will be minus 1.3. So we see that this is actually minus 1 plus minus 0.3. So once again, and this is the result which is slightly tricky. If D is equal to A minus B, that means delta D is still equal to delta A plus delta B. And this is what you need to know. If you add two quantities, the corresponding errors add up. Absolute errors, not relative. If you add two quantities, the corresponding absolute errors add up. If you subtract two quantities, still the corresponding errors add up. They do not subtract. And this is important. You need to remember this. Right. So we've seen how to calculate the error of the sum of two quantities whose errors which we know. We've seen how to calculate the error of a quantity which is the difference of two quantities whose errors we know. Let's move on to multiplication and division. So again, let's say A is equal to average plus minus delta A. And let's say a quantity E is equal to AB and a quantity F is equal to A by B. So the quantity A can be written as E can be written as A average B average plus minus delta E. This can be written as A average by B average plus minus delta F. Right, we need to find out delta E and delta F in terms of delta A and delta B. Right, so I'm just going to give you the formulas. I'm not going to prove them in this place, nor am I going to show you how they might come about, because we'll prove them soon enough once we learn differentiation. The formulas come about from differentiation, so we'll learn how to derive them once we do differentiation. Right now, I'll just write the formulas, and the key thing is, when you add or subtract two quantities, it's the relative errors which add. Sorry, it's the absolute errors which add. But when you multiply or divide two quantities, we know the relation between relative errors. We do not know the relation between absolute errors. So if E is equal to AB, then delta E by E equals delta A by A plus delta B by B. And delta F by F is also equal to delta A by A plus delta B. So when you add or subtract, it's the absolute errors which add up, but when you multiply or divide, it's the relative errors which add up, not the absolute errors. And this is not all. Actually, you can have an even better formula, an even more generalized formula. If X is equal to A to the power alpha, B to the power beta, C to the power gamma, then delta X by X equals alpha times delta A by A, alpha times the relative error in A, plus beta times delta B by B, plus gamma times delta C. Right. So we saw a formula in the first class where time period we calculated using dimensional analysis came out to be K root of L by G. So that means the relative error delta T by T will be half of delta L by L. Half because root of L is L to the power half, plus half of delta G by G. I'm not going to prove this right now. We will prove this once we reach differentiation. Right now, you do need to remember this. So, if we know the values of two quantities in terms of in the form of A average plus minus delta A and B average plus minus delta B, we can calculate the errors of any quantity which is made from using these quantities, either by addition, subtraction, multiplication or division, because we found out how to calculate the errors in each separate cases. When two quantities are added, the absolute errors add up, and with two quantities are multiplied or divided, is the relative errors which add up.
Okay.
The next concept which we need to see is rounding of numbers. Now, rounding of numbers generally is easy enough, except there might be one case which you haven't seen earlier, which we'll tell you now, which is what happens when the last digit is 5. Generally, some books they teach that when the last digit is 5, you increase it by 1. Some of them say you don't do it. But both of them ultimately end up adding a number of errors. Because let's say you calculate, calculate the time and it comes out to be 18.5, 18.2, 18.6, 18.5, 18.4. This you'll round off as 18, this you'll round off as 19, this you'll round off as 18. What will you round off this or this as? And what happens is, let's say we get values between 16 and 20, let's say. So some places we'll have 17.5, some places we'll have 16.5. So the rule is, if every time we 18.5 we evaluate to 19, and every time 17.5 we evaluate to 18, and every time 16.5 we round it off to 17, then we're just adding a value every time, and it's going to end up giving our answer greater than we want. So we compensated by adding one half of the time and not adding one half the time. So whenever the digit just before 5 is odd, then we increase by 1, and when it is even, we do not increase by 1. So 18.5 remains 18, 17.5 becomes 18, 16.5 becomes remains 16, 18.5235. If we want to round it off to 5 significant digits, we'll understand significant digits soon enough. Then it'll become 18.524. But if this was 18.5245, still it'll become 18.524. So in this way, half the time we increase it by 1 and half the time we don't increase it by 1, so that we can compensate for the errors which we would commit if we increase it by 1 every time. So apart from this, I'm sure you know how to round off. This is the part which gives students a lot of trouble because this is new to them. The next topic is significant figures.